मैं ऑडिबल सर? Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. You are audible. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. And good afternoon, Nagaraja sir, Sinha sir, Pati sir, and other distinguished guests sitting on the dais, off the dais, all the prospective bidders, all the stakeholders. I can see Anil Agrawal sir, Chairman Vedanta Group, and I welcome all the members who are participating in this session. Through video conferencing, I need to attach my presentation. It says host disabled participant screen sharing. I am requesting my
host. Can you allow us to share screening?
Someone will have to sir operate the presentation, sir.
You operate, yeah. Okay, we will operate. Come.
Who is there? Ek one.
Question.
Okay, sir. Can we start, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, sir. This is a presentation, a small presentation about these 41 coal blocks which have been identified for auction through for commercial mining purpose. Can we have the next slide? So this is the state-wise distribution of the 41 coal blocks. There are in the five different states. There are 33 CMSP coal blocks and 8 MMDR coal blocks. Total 41 blocks with a total peak rated capacity of about 225 million ton. CMSP, that is which has been with the block which have been deallocated by the Supreme Court decision, and MMDR are the new ones. Can we go next slide, please? This is the distribution of the coal blocks by the quality. There are 30 non-coking coal blocks under CMSP, 7 MMDR, total 37 being the non-coking coal blocks at TRC of 222.55. There are two coking coal blocks with TRC of 0.93 million ton per year, and coking and non-coking mixed block we are having two and total capacity of 1.2 million ton. Next, please. So first of all, we will be discussing about the 33 CMSP block. This is the state of Chhattisgarh, sir. The first block is Fatehpur East. This is the Raigarh district under Mann Raigarh coal field. Area is 18 square kilometer and geological reserves of around 298 million ton. This is an explored block with a peak rated capacity of 10 million ton. For this block, we have the mining plan approved by the prior lottie, and there is one condition that this is under high conservation zone. This is Garepalma sector 4x1. Again, this is in the Mann Raigarh coal field under Raigarh district. Area 10 square kilometer with the 6 million ton per year capacity, and it has all the clearances with the prior lottie. ICCL is currently the custodian of this mine. The next one is Garepalma. Again, this is in Chhattisgarh, Mann Raigarh coal field and Raigarh district. This is a 4.82 square kilometer area with the detailed exploration and all clearances. 1.2 million ton capacity, and currently SECL is the custodian of this mine. This is Madanagar North coal block under Korba district of Hasdev Arun coal field in Chhattisgarh state, 21 square kilometer. Am I audible, sir? I am not able to see the presentation.
Yeah, we are audible. Presentation also clear. Please go ahead.
So I was talking about this Madan Nagar. It has It already is having approved mining plan with the prior allottee. And of course, it is Hasdev Varan coalfield is under high conservation zone. Actually, I am not able to see the presentation, the screen, the dais.
Okay, you have a presentation copy with you.
Yes, sir, I have, but
go ahead.
I am on the same page. Next block is Morga 2 coal block, sir. It is under Hasdev Varan coalfield again, Korba district, with the state of Chhattisgarh. This is the having a 10 million ton capacity. The capacity has been assessed by CMPDI.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Mr. Sharan, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Morga 2, I am on the page of Morga 2, sir. Again, this particular block is regionally explored block. It has to be worked through PL cum ML basis. And coming to the next block is Sayang coal block. This is under Korba and Raigarh district, Raigarh coal field. Again, and it has to be worked through PL cum ML route. And the capacity has been assessed by CPD around 4 million ton per year. Next one is Shankarpur Bhadgaon 2 extension. This is again in the Chhattisgarh state, Sarguja district, and Bishampur coalfield. It has some seams which are not very thick, and 2 million ton capacity of open cast and underground mines have been planned. And approved mining plan has been prepared by the prior allottee, and it is available with a peak rated capacity of 2 million ton per year. Coming to the next block is Sondhia block. Sondhia block, Chhattisgarh state, Sarguja district, Tathapani Ramkola coalfield is. The block is having an area of 10.74 square kilometer. It's an explored block with 50 million ton reserves and 1 million ton capacity. And the prior allottee has prepared the mining plan of 1 million ton, which is available. The stripping ratio, of course, in this coal block is high. And the seam thickness is not very high. Now, sir, Chakla block in the state of Jharkhand. We are now discussing the coal blocks of Jharkhand state. District Latehar. Is North Kanpura coalfield. Area is 8.63 square kilometers. It's an explored block with 76 million ton reserves and 5.3 million ton capacity by open cast. We have the mining plan approved by the prior allottee, and evacuation infrastructure is also available very near to this coal block. And the only issue will be high conservation zone. Next block is Gondolpada. It's again North Kanpura coalfield of Jharkhand state, and the Hazaribagh is a district. 4.1 square kilometers the area. Actually, someone has not muted his microphone. Can I request?
North. Yeah, Sirgiras.
Now Gondolpada, 4.1 square kilometer. Again, it's a North Kanpura coalfield. It's Hazaribagh district with the 4 million capacity mines and 176 million ton coal reserves. Mining plan was prepared by the prior allottee, and it is available. The issue will be the coal seams are steeply dipping in this coal block. Next one is the Chitarpur coal block. Again, this is the North Kanpura coalfield, Latehar district. Block area is 5.6 square kilometer with 242 million ton of reserves. The block has been explored in detail. Mining plan of this particular block is available, and the PRC of this coal block is 3.45 million ton per year. Next one is the Choritan Tilaiya, Jharkhand state, Bokaro district, and West Bokaro coal field. So this block is having washery grade coal, sir. It has different grades of washery grade, and the average is slightly inferior to washery 4. So washery 5 is the overall grade, and the PRC of this particular project is 0.78 million ton per year. 97 million ton is the total reserves, and the mining plan has been prepared by the prior lottery. It has some issue related to hilly terrain with forest cover. Next block is, sir, North Dhadu. It's again Latehar district of North Kanpura coal field. Area is 11.33 square kilometer. It's a detailed explored block. Huge reserves of 9.4 million ton with PRC of 8.15 million ton capacity, which has been prepared by the prior lottery. The coal infrastructure, the railway line from Tori to Daltonganj passes near to this block. The only issues related to these blocks are steep gradient of the coal seams, and one Barki river is passing through the coal block. And there is one issue of high conservation zone. Next block is Seregada coal block. Latehar district, North Kanpura coal field. It's a small block of 3.7 square kilometer with 187 million ton reserves. The block has been explored in detail, and we have the mining plan prepared by the prior LRT. The peak rated capacity of this particular coal block will be 4 million ton per year. Again, this block is situated very near to the Tori Daltonganj main railway lines. Next block is Brahmadiha coal block. This coal block is situated in Giridih district of Jharkhand state. It's a small coal block of 0.87 square kilometer, but the major point, important point of this block is that it is having steel 1 grade of coal. We have a 0.15 million ton capacity of approved mining plan of made prepared by the prior lottery. Of course, the reserves are totally 5 million ton, but the grade of coal is very good, steel 1 grade. Next block is Rajahara North, Central and Eastern. This block is situated in Daltonganj coal field in Palamu district of Jharkhand state. It's also a small block, 1.09 square kilometer is the area. The block has been explored in detail. It has its mining plan prepared by the prior lottery. Geological resource are 20 million ton, and the peak rate capacity of 0.75 million ton mining plan is available. The block is under high conservation zone. This is one of the issues. Next block of Jharkhand state is Urma Pahadi Tola. This block lies in Dumka and Pakur districts of Rajmahal coal field. It is partially explored coal block of 9.76 square kilometer. It has the reserves have been assessed as 579 million ton. The PRC has been assessed by CMPDI based on the data available of 10 million ton. Average grade has been assessed as G10, and this block has to be offered through prospecting lease come mining lease. There is one Bansloi river is bisecting this coal block, is passing through the middle of this coal block. This block is also under high conservation zone. Now we are coming to the Madhya Pradesh state, Thesagora B Rudrapuri coal block. This block is 5.25 square kilometer block. It is explored, and the mining plan of 1 million ton capacity has been prepared by the prior lottery. It is having its approval also. It's an underground coal mine of 1 million ton capacity. The total reserves of this coal block is 45 million ton, and the grade is G9. Next block is Shahpur East. Shahpur East is situated in Shahdol and Umaria districts of Madhya Pradesh state. The coal field is Sohagpur. 6.59 square kilometer is the area. The block has been explored in detail with total reserves of 63 million ton. It has a mining plan approved with 0.7 million ton per year capacity. The grade of the coal is G8. The adjacent to this block is next block, Shahpur West, Madhya Pradesh state, Shahdol and Umaria district, Sohagpur coal field, 6.19 square kilometer. It's also an explored block, 53 million ton total reserves. Peak rated capacity of 0.6 million ton underground mine has been approved by the ministry and is available. Total grade of this particular block has been assessed at G7. Next block is Urtan North block. It is again in Sohagpur coal field and in Anuppur district of Madhya Pradesh state. This block is 4.77 square kilometer block. It is explored in detail. 70 million ton total reserves, 0.6 million ton per year capacity by underground mine. It has a partly washery grade coal and partly thermal coal. Mining plan prepared by the prior LOT is available, but approval is not available for this particular block. It has a coking coal and the railway line Anuppur Bishampur railway line passes very near from this coal block. The next two blocks of Madhya Pradesh state is the Ghotitoria East and Ghotitoria West. It is in the Narsinghpur district of Mopani coal field. It's an isolated deposit. 2.14 square kilometers is the total area. The blocks has been explored in detail. These are scheduled two coal mines. Already it has all the clearances. Peak rated capacity is 0.3 million ton per year by open cast method. The grade of coal is G8. And it has all statutory clearances, good quality coal, as well as the only issue is there are two separate small coal blocks in close proximity. Next block is Marki Barka block of Madhya Pradesh state, Singrauli coal field, main basin, district Singrauli. The area is 6.9 square kilometers, it's also an explored block with 72 million ton resource. 1 million ton is the capacity of this particular block. It has approved mining plan prepared by the prior LOT. And it has some evacuation constraint because it does not have any railway line very near to this particular block. Now we are coming to Maharashtra state, Bandher coal block. This block is situated in Chandrapur coal field. The district is Chandrapur and the coal field is Bandher. 17.4 square kilometers the area. The block has been explored. The total reserves is 126 million ton with 2 million ton PRC. This PRC has been assessed by CMPDI because the mining plan of this particular coal block was not available. Grade of this particular block is quite good, G7 grade. This block also lies under high conservation zone. Next block of Maharashtra state is Marki Mangli 2. This block lies in Yavatmal district and the Wardha Valley coalfield is the coalfield where this block is situated. Area is 3.4 square kilometer. The block has been explored in detail. 11.54 million ton the total reserves. PRC 0.3 million ton per year and by open cast method. The grade is also quite good. G8 grade. This is also a scheduled 2 mine with all the clearances available. Next block is Tekli Jena Bellora North and Tekli Jena Bellora South. This block is again in Chandrapur district under Wardha Valley coal field. 9.36 square kilometers the area. This block has been explored in detail, but the mining plan is not available, so the capacity has been assessed by 1.5 million ton by CMPDI. The grade of coal is G8. The main railway line passes very near from this coal block. This is an advantage of this particular block. Next block, we are coming to now Orissa state. Chendipada and Chendipada 2. These are the two coal blocks which have been allocated to prior LOT. The areas are 8.16 and 18.99 square kilometer respectively. It is explored block. The total reserves in these two blocks is 559 million ton and 1350 million ton, around 2 billion ton. This mine has an approved mining plan of 40 million ton capacity by open cast mining, and the grade of coal is G10. The only issue is that at present it does not have an infrastructure available for evacuation of 40 million ton capacity mine. It needs to be, the infrastructure needs to be there. Next block of Orissa state is Machhakata and Mahanadi. This is again in Angul district and Talcher coal field. The area is 20.33 square kilometer and 31.39 square kilometer. These are the two coal blocks which have, which were allocated to prior lottie. It also, it, this, these two blocks also have combined approved mining plan by the prior lottie. The capacity of the mine is 30 million ton per year, and the reserves are for around 2.4 billion ton. Again, the infrastructure will be required for coal evacuation from this Machhakata and Mahanadi. Coming to the next block of Orissa state is Radhikapur East. This block lies in Angul district of Talcher coal field. The area is 10.16 square kilometer. This block has been explored in detail. 176 is the total geological resource with 5 million ton PRC by open cast mining. The grade is G13. The mining approved mining plan by, prepared by the prior lot is available with us, and the coal evacuation infrastructure is required for this Radhikapur East. The next block is the Radhikapur West. Again, Angul district, the Talcher coal field. Area is 10.29 square kilometer. This block is also explored in detail with 312 million ton total geological resource. Peak rated capacity of 6 million ton is available, which has been approved under mining plan. The average grade is again G13. Again, for these two coal blocks, Radhikapur East and Radhikapur West, coal evacuation infrastructure would be required. So these were the 33 coal blocks which were under CMSP. Now we are coming to MMDR coal blocks. MMDR coal blocks, again, we have one block in Chhattisgarh state, four blocks in Madhya Pradesh, and three blocks in Odisha state. Total eight coal blocks we are having under MMDR in this round of auction. First block is Morga South coal block, Chhattisgarh state, Korba district, Hasdev Aran coal field. Area is 21.92 square kilometer. Exploration is status, this block is explored in detail with geological resource of 433 million ton. The 6 million ton mine has, capacity has been assessed by CMPDI. The grade of coal of this coal block is G10. The issue is that the major area is under protected forest, and because this block lies in Hasdev Aran coal field. Next is the Madhya Pradesh state, Singrauli coal field. Dhirauli is the name of the coal block. Area is 26.72 square kilometer. The exploration has been completed with geological resource of 586 million ton. Peak rated capacity of 3 million ton by open cast has been assessed by CMPDI. The grade of coal is quite good, G8. Mining plan has to be prepared. Grade of coal, as I have already told you, grade of coal is good, and there will be an issue of high forest cover. Next block is Marwatola sector 6 and sector 7. This block is in again Madhya Pradesh state in Shahdol district, Sohagpur coal field. The total area is 22.17 square kilometer. This is explored block, 3.5 million ton total geological resources, and the peak rated capacity is 4 million ton, which has been assessed by CMPDI. The grade is quite good, G9, and Shahdol Pali road passes through the coal block. It has some forest cover. Next block is Urtan coal block. Again, the state is Madhya Pradesh and Sohagpur coal field. District is Anuppur. 3.79 square kilometers is the area. The block has been explored in detail. 55 million ton is the total geological resources, and 0.65 million ton underground mine capacity has been assessed by CMPDI. This block, again like Urtan North, this block is again having some washery grade seams and some thermal coal seams. So It has some difficult geological structures, and the benefit is that this block is having coking coal reserves as well. Again, next district is of Madhya Pradesh is Bandha block, Singrauli district and Singrauli coal fields in the main basin. The area of the block is 18.44 square kilometer. It's a partially explored block. 442 million ton has been assessed as per indicated reserves. This is going to be an underground mine with 5 million ton capacity, huge potential as underground mine. Grade of coal is quite good, G7 grade. This block will be offered through prospecting lease cum mining lease, PL cum ML route. It's very close to existing coal evacuation infrastructure because the Singrauli-Katni line passes very adjacent to this coal block. Now we are coming to Orissa state. As I told you, Orissa is having 3 MMDR coal blocks. The first one is Brahmanbilg and Kardabahal. As you know, Talcher coal field is having very thick coal seams, and this block is in an area of 9.87 square kilometers, having a reserves of 1.067 billion ton. The PRC has been assessed by 45 million ton. The grade of coal has been assessed as the G12. Mining plan has to be prepared. The only issue will be that this mine may have an issue of overburden dumping. Space may not be sufficient for increasing the capacity of this block. Next coal block of Odisha state is Kurloi A North, 9.60 square kilometer with the 1.68 billion ton reserve. Exploration status is this block has been explored. The PRC of this particular block has been assessed as 8 million ton per year. Again, this block will be having an issue of overburden dumping because of the space constraint, which will restrict its capacity to say 8 to 10 million ton. The last block is Fuljari East and West in Orissa state, Angul district, Talcher coal field. The block is 9.44 square kilometer. This block has also been explored in detail. This block is having a geological resource of 2211. Around 2.2 billion ton. The peak rated capacity has been assessed as 10 million ton with G13 grade. This block will also be having some dumping related issues because of the space constraint. Also, coal evacuation infrastructure will also be required for this coal block. So, this is a brief about all these coal blocks, and a lot of details are available for all these coal blocks in the CMPD and Ministry of Coal website, where we have uploaded the coal block details of 80 coal blocks, where individual block is having its own block summary, where all these details will be available. And again, I think this we can share this presentation with all prospective bidders. Vicky can share this block, this presentation, and in case of any questions, we'll be having that round after say half an hour or 30-35 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah, we have, we will have a SBA presentation. Thereafter, we'll have some questions. Now, I request SBA CAP to Mr. Shubham Goyal. He will make the presentation.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. As SBI CAPS, the transaction advisor to Ministry of Coal, we welcome you all to this historic launch event of commercial coal mine auction. I'll give you a brief presentation on the process of auction. This will be the agenda of the presentation. We'll run you through the brief background, the pre-auction activities, the auction process, post-auction activities, and some salient terms of the auction. The background, this auction is being conducted on the under the aegis of CMSP Act and MMDR Act, and this has been approved by the Cabinet. Recently, amendment has been made to CMSP Act and MMDR Act to account for the auction of unexplored and partially explored coal mines for PL cum ML. All the auction will be for sale of coal. There will be no restriction on the usage of coal. The mineral concession rules 2020, CMSP amendment rules, and coal block allocation rules all have been notified. One of the attractive feature of this auction is an attempt to move towards a free market regime and the implementation of the National Coal Index, which has been implemented and notified. Further, amendment has been made in the FDI policy to allow for 100% FDI under automatic rule for sale of coal under coal mine. Some of the key features which have already been discussed in the past are no restriction on sale or utilization of coal. So the bidders are free to utilize coal for their captive use, for commercial use, for sale of coal, or even for export. There is a migration from percentage migration to percentage revenue share instead of rupees per ton in the earlier regime. Now bidders will have to bid for a percentage share on the revenue on the bidding platform. There is no technical and financial eligibility criteria, so there is ease in entry. And any bidder who is willing to participate in this auction, this is the right time to come forth and participate. Then there is an implementation of National Coal Index, which I have mentioned that had already been implemented. We'll have a brief presentation on the methodology of National Coal Index in the next presentation. The minimum number of bidders have been reduced from 3 to 2 for a successful round of auction. There has been a greater flexibility in coal production schedule. Now bidders have the autonomy to, you know, manage the production schedule as per their own requirement. They can produce up to 65% of the production, scheduled production in a year, or at 75% of the scheduled production in a block of 3 years without any penal provisions. Further, there is incentive on early production. A rebate of 50% on the final offer has been provided in case of production has come prior to the scheduled date of production. And further, there's an incentive on utilization of coal in coal gasification and coal liquefaction. A rebate of 20% on the final offer has been provided for such activity. And further, there is a relaxed payment structure. The upfront amount, the performance security have all been rationalized in view of the current scenario. So, and also to keep in mind that the financial burden of the on the bidders have been minimized. Some of the pre-auction, e-auction activities are, the bidders will have to go on the electronic platform of MSTC. They'll have to register on the electronic platform. For registration, they will have to submit few documents, which are PAN, passport size photographs, letter of authorization, proof of identity, and copy of confirmation email. Once they register on the electronic platform, the bidders will be eligible to download the documents from the portal. There are two set of documents. One is available free of cost, which are the standard terms of the bidding terms, standard documents, and the mine summaries. These can be downloaded at free of cost. There are other set of documents which are mine specific detailed documents covering detailed data, GR, and everything. These can be downloaded by the bidders after making a payment of rupees 5 lakhs per coal mine. Then the bidders are also encouraged to do site visits and due diligence. And for that, they have to coordinate with the nominated authority at the link provided. And accordingly, the site visits will be arranged. Then we also have the pre-bid conferences. A maximum of 3 representatives from each bidder shall be allowed in the pre-bid conferences. We'll take Q&A sessions over there, and we'll also run you through the detailed auction process again during those pre-bid conferences. This is how the auction process will look like. It's a two-stage online e-auction process. The first stage would be the technical bid, and the second stage would be the financial bid. In the technical bid, the bidders will have to comply with all the eligibility conditions, the requirements, have to submit the documents, and also the initial price offer, which the bidders have to submit along with the technical bid. And in the second stage of the financial bid, the bidders will be allowed to, qualified bidders will be allowed to participate in the forward auction, and the bidders will be asked to submit their bids in revenue share. So bid parameter shall be the percentage share of revenue. The floor price has been capped at 4%. The bidders are encouraged to bid in a multiple of 0.5% up to the revenue share reaches 10%, and beyond 10%, the bidders will be allowed to bid in a multiple of 0.25%. However, each bidder shall be allowed to submit only one bid for a particular coal mine. No affiliate of any bidder shall be allowed to submit the bid for the said coal mine. And the, in case that happens, the bid of the bidder and the affiliate shall be rejected. These are along with the technical bid, the bidders will have to submit the bid security. The bid security has been divided into two components. For the fully explored mines, the bid security is equal to 20% of the upfront amount, and for the partially explored mine, the bid security is equal to 25% of the estimated exploration expenditure based on the mandatory work program. The validity of the bid security shall not be less than 270 days. The eligibility criteria, there is no as such significant eligibility criteria, only that the bidders will have to, the bidder has to be a company registered in incorporated in India, and could be a government company or a private company or a JV company, but it has to be registered incorporated in India. In addition to that, there are certain additional conditions. In case the bidder is a prior allottee, then he must have paid the additional levy within the time period prescribed in the scheme tender document, and he should not have been conducted for any offense related to coal block allocation, and should not have sentenced with imprisonment of more than 3 years. Once the technical bid is opened, the bidders who have submitted the technical bid will be termed, will be declared as a technically qualified bidders. The bidders who have who meet the eligibility condition, then the IPO, the initial offer submitted by the technically qualified bidders, will be opened, and based on that IPO, the ranking will be made of the of all the technically qualified bidders, and a ranking and elimination round will be carried out to determine the qualified bidders. Now, how the ranking and elimination process will take place? All the technically qualified bidders shall be ranked in accordance with the IPO they have submitted in the descending order. So, bidder who has submitted the highest IPO will be ranked first, and subsequently, the bidder who has submitted the lowest IPO will be ranked last. The bidders who have submitted the same IPO will be given the same rank. So in how the bidders elimination will take place, in case there are only two or three technically qualified bidders, all such technically qualified bidders will be considered as qualified bidders. Now, if there are four to six technically qualified bidders, then the lowest ranked technically qualified bidder shall be eliminated, and the remaining shall move towards the second round of auction and termed as qualified bidders. If there are seven or more technically qualified bidders, then 1/3 of the technically qualified bidders, subject to a maximum of three technically qualified bidders, shall be eliminated, basically the lowest ranked. And if there are more than three technically qualified bidders at the lowest rank, all technically qualified bidders shall be eliminated, and the remaining bidders shall be considered as a qualified bidders. However, in case after the ranking and elimination process, the number of qualified bidders falls below three, then all the technically qualified bidders will move to the second stage of auction, which is the e-auction stage, where bidders will submit their e-bids. Now, the applicable floor price from the, for the second stage of auction shall be the highest IPO submitted during the IPO stage. That will become the reserve price for that. The bidders will have to bid over and above that. The qualified bidders who will submitting the highest financial offer shall be declared as the preferred bidder, and upon the directions and approvals from the central government, the preferred bidder shall be declared as a successful bidder. The CMDPA, the agreement shall be executed with the successful bidder. After the execution of the agreement, the bidders will be asked to submit the upfront amount, first installment of upfront amount, fixed amount, and the performance security, post which the vesting order shall be issued to the successful bidder. And upon execution of the vesting order, the successful bidder shall be entitled to PL or ML as applicable. Now, as I mentioned in the second slide, that payment structures have been rationalized. So one of the critical component of that is the upfront amount. Now, upfront amount has been revised to 2.25% of the value of estimated GR of the coal mine. Earlier it was linked to the NPV of the coal mine. Now it has been linked to the estimated GR of the coal mine. Further, the cap has been put on the amount of upfront amount basis reserves available in the coal mine. So if the reserves are geological reserves in a coal mine is up to 200 million ton, the upfront amount is capped at rupees 100 crores. And if the geological reserves under the in the coal mine is more than 200 million ton, the upfront amount is capped at 500 crores. Now, this how the value of estimated geological reserves shall be computed? It is equal to the GR, geological reserves in a coal mine, multiplied by the representative price of the relevant grade of coal based on the national coal index. So, and upfront amount shall be, this is an additional feature, that the upfront amount shall be adjusted in full against the monthly payments to be made to the state government. So this upfront amount is adjustable against the monthly payments. However, for a particular year, only up to 50% of the aggregated monthly payments of the for the year shall be adjusted. Now, upfront amount shall be payable by the successful bidder in 4 equal installments. Earlier there were 3 installments. Now it has been revised to 4 equal installments of 25% each. And how those installments will pan out to be is provided in this slide. That first installment for the upfront amount has been categorized under different categories of mine. First is Schedule 2 mines and fully explored mines under MMDR and CMSP Act. And then there are partially explored mines under MMDR and CMSP Act. For Schedule 2 mines, the first installment shall be paid within 40 business days of the execution of the agreement. And for fully explored and partially explored mine, for fully explored mine also within 40 days of the execution of the agreement. But for the partially explored mine, it is within 40 days of the in-principle approval of the mining plan. The second installment for Schedule 2 mine shall be paid within 6 months from the date of issuance of the vesting order. And for the fully explored and partially explored mine, within 15 business days of execution of the mining lease or the order by the central government. Third installment shall be paid within 9 months from the date of issuance of the vesting order for the Schedule 2 mines. For the fully explored and partially explored mine, it should be within 15 days of the grant of the coal mine opening permission. And the fourth and the last installment shall be paid within 12 months from the date of issuance of the vesting order for the Schedule 2 mines, and for fully explored and partially explored mine within 15 days of the date of commencement of the coal production. In addition to the upfront amount, the other payments which need to be made by the successful bidder are the fixed amount and the performance security. The fixed amount shall be paid prior to the issuance of the vesting order, and it will include value of land, cost of clearances, consents, cost of GR, and cost incurred by CMPDL and other government agencies in deriving detailed geological boundary coordinates and preparation of GR. The performance security has again been classified under two categories, for fully explored mines and for partially unexplored mines. For fully explored mine, the performance security shall be equal to 65% of the aggregate of 1 year royalty and 1 year revenue computed based on the peak rated capacity of the coal mine. For unexplored and partially explored mine, prior to the in principle approval of the mining plan, the performance security to be submitted by the bidder is equal to 25% of the estimated exploration expenditure. Once the mine in principle approval of the mining plan is there, then the similar process as in case of fully explored mines shall be followed, and the bids, the performance security should be revised to 65% of the aggregate of the 1 year royalty and 1 year revenue computed based on the PRC of the mine. In addition to the fixed amount and performance security, there are monthly payments that needs to be made by the successful bidder after the allocation of the mine based on the production profile. That shall be based on the final offer, that is a percentage revenue share quoted by the bidder during the bid process. And revenue share shall be the product of final offer into the quantity of coal produced on the basis on which the statutory royalty is payable during the month, and the notional price or the actual price, whichever is higher. Now, for this purpose, a notional price is a price arrived at the after adjusting the representative price with the sub-index of national coal index. Now, national coal index is basically the basket for different basket of goods. There's a national coal index comprises of notified price of coal, imported price of coal, and the e-auction price of coal. So, basis that the notional price will be computed, and the representative price shall be the product of weights of the base year and the latest available price of these components at the time of issuance of the tender document. Now, representative price and these prices have been published recently for the purpose of this auction. We also have a detailed presentation on the same after my presentation is over, which will clarify all the doubts related to National Coal Index and the pricing. Other statutory dues, including taxes, royalty, contribution of NMET, DMF, shall be payable as per the applicable law. Now, in addition to this, there are certain salient terms of this auction. There is a flexibility in coal production schedule, which I've already discussed, that you have the autonomy to adjust the production up to 65% for a year and 75% over a block of 3 years. Then there is no restriction on sale and utilization of coal. You can use it for captive use. You can sell it in the market. You can even export the coal. Additional feature is a relinquishment of the partially explored mine. Once the mandatory work program has been completed in accordance with the prospecting operations and all, the bidder shall have the right to relinquish the partially explored mine. But the catch here is that the partially explored mine can be relinquished in full. No part relinquishment is allowed. Then there is also rights available to exploit CBM and minor minerals. This is a new feature so that to provide ease in exploitation. In case the bidder so desires and assess the presence of CBM and minor minerals in the coal mine, he can after notification to NA and Ministry of MOPNG, he can exploit CBM and minor mineral presence in the coal field in accordance with the applicable law. In addition to this, incentives on early production, as I have already discussed, is there of 50% rebate on the final offer submitted by the bidder, and in case of coal gasification, 20% rebate on the quantity of coal consumed or sold or both for coal gasification. Further, to enable financing options, a provision for creation of security has also been stipulated in the tender document, and the bidders are free to create security through mortgage over the coal mine, which will help the bidders in gaining access to financing. Further, the change of control is also allowed under this scheme of auction. So these were some of the salient features of the auction process. Thank you so much. If you have any queries, we'll be willing to take it up in the next session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shubham. Now I have with me Mr. Anupam Lahiri, Deputy Director General, Statistics Ministry of Coal. I request him to make the presentation on the National Coal Index.
Good afternoon to all. In this presentation, I will be dealing with one topic which is of paramount importance in the current commercial mining situation. This is National Coal Index, and second is representative price. All the calculations of upfront price, valuation of coal block, revenue share, and so on will be determined by your representative price and also National Coal Index. How it will be determined, these are all explained in the tender model tender document. In this presentation, I will take up only those matters which clarify the concept as to what National Coal Index is, how it is calculated, and what is its interpretation. National Coal Index is like a price index. In coal sector, there are so many indices which are popular, like ICI 1234, API 1234, and so on, based on the quality of coal and contract under which the coal is delivered. These indices gives the price of a coal at a particular date or particular month. But the National Coal Index, in contrast, gives the index of price level as compared to a base year. In the present NCI, which we have developed, their base period is financial year 17-18, and based on this, NCI has been calculated. On 4th June, we have issued the office memorandum rolling out the NCI, which has given the NCI up to March 20. And in that office memorandum, one small page write-up I have attempted to give the short description of how NCI has been calculated and what are its respective weights. To be very simple, it is the index based on prices of coal from all sales channels like notified price, auction price and import price, and its weights are determined by way of based on the transaction value of coal in each sales channel that was prevalent in 1718. Now, NCI, though we are calling it as a national coal index, but for all practical purpose, we will be using the five indices at subsector level, like non-coking top grade from G1 to G6, non-coking medium grade from G7 to G14, non-coking low grade from G15 to G17, coking top grade that comprising steel grade 1 and 2, and coking coal bottom grade consisting of Wasari 1 to Wasari 4 grade. Their weights, I am not showing it, these are all available. And second important point is the representative price. As I had already mentioned that the coal industry is familiar with the different types of index like ICI 1, 2. This is this representative price is broadly similar, not exactly, but broadly similar to that index. This is the average of coal price on a specified date for a particular grade. We have attempted to notify the representative price for each grade G1 to G17 and steel grade 1, 2 and Wasari grade 1 to 4. Wasari 5 and Wasari 6 are not there. As these are the average price of coal, their weights, when we are averaging, their weights are based on the quantity of sold coal sold under each sale channels for each grade. For each grade, the respective weights under the three channels like notified price, auction price and import price are different. Now, all the liabilities like the upfront payment, which are all based on the this representative price, and when we will be calculating the revenue share after the production commences, these will be computed on the basis of representative price linked to the NCI of that particular period. On 6th June, we have notified the representative price also for all the grades of coal. And this has been incorporated in the model tender document. And on that basis, all the things will be done. Now, these are most of the, in brief, the preliminary things. And we have taken more time for question answer session. And I have made very brief presentation on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Anupam. For the presentation on the National Coal Index. Now, those of the guests who are on the virtually connected, it's not be possible for us to take the questions online. But what we have done was to send us questions in advance. So we have received a number of questions relating to coal specific coal block, National Coal Index, and other policy matters. Some of them, I think, during our presentations might have been answered. And others, we would like to, couple of them, I think, I'll answer, and a couple of them I'll request my colleagues to answer. And thereafter, if there are any, then I think we will, you may send us in writing, and then all the questions and answers to these will be on the website, on the both the MSTC website as well as the Ministry of Coal website, so that any question raised by any bidder or prospective bidder is transparently available to the rest of the bidders. Now, one question, the first question I think several people asked is whether the government is planning to acquire land for the private sector also. Currently, the thinking is that we wanted to, as you know, the context of use of coal has changed internationally. And we would like to extract as much coal as possible, as fast as possible, so that we can achieve better developmental outcomes in the country and also energy security. Therefore, what we are actually doing is in this, under the CBA, Coal Bearing Areas Act, we are basically following the same compensation regime that is available under the existing Law Act, but we are only expediting the process of acquiring the land for the coal bearing companies, and we are thinking of extending the same benefit. We have prepared a proposal, as our Honorable Minister has mentioned in his speech today morning. We have prepared a proposal. The proposal we have sent to the coal bearing area states for consultations. It's almost about 2 weeks ago. And once we have their views and suggestions, then we would like to finalize that, with the hope that we would like to provide the same level playing field to both the private sector as well as the public sector in acquiring land for coal mining. The second set of questions are related to getting clearances, PMU, and all those tough kind of questions. Now, I have in the morning, I have mentioned that we have set up 2 months ago a project management unit to help us, to help the nominated authority, to also the coal mining allocatees to expeditiously get the clearances from the central government as well as the state governments. Now, the consultant we engaged is KPMG. They have been working in the last 2 months. They have been working despite the COVID. We have completed the consultations with most the allocatees, and we know the problems and the issues involved. We have been taking up with a large number of state governments individually in specific complaints of coal blocks allocatees. We are taking up. We are also taken up with the Ministry of Environment and Forests, and. Apart from this, we are also starting the single window system for ensuring that Parvesh is also linked with our single window system, so that the permissions and approvals required are at one place, and then we will be able to monitor for better outcomes. Another set of questions relating to import substitution steps taken by the Government of India. I request my colleague Mr. Rajesh Sinha to respond to that. Before that, I'll also ask talk about this level playing field to small industries. In the morning, we have mentioned the coal. We want to give a level playing field to small, medium, and big industries to bid for the coal blocks. The smallest mine that is on offer is 0.25 MT. So I think we can't go smaller than that. I think that is the smallest mine in our basket. Now the new companies also can bid in. The smallest mine, the upfront fee is very, very little. And so they can bid it, they can sell the coal or sell the small industries, and they can have equal playing field. We don't have any discrimination on that. And we'll be, in fact, welcome the small players to come into the market, so that market is much more democratic. Now, the questions on the relating to is, is there any cap on the maximum revenue share? Yeah, no, there is no cap. There is a minimum cap, 4%, but there is no maximum cap on maximum share. We would actually like to have maximum share, because the underdeveloped states like Jharkhand, Orissa, and Chhattisgarh, they'll get more revenue, and then they will use this money for their developmental needs. National Coal Index, my colleague Mr. Anupam Lahiri has explained. We have issued recently, past 10-15 days, a few orders on the National Coal Index. They are all available in our website. And I think maybe today or tomorrow, we are going to also issue the responsibilities. And yesterday issued, okay, we have issued one more order yesterday. So all these are available in our website on the National Coal Index, very detailed manner. And by the way, to add to him, the coal index, they largely contributed by Indian Statistical Institute, who have developed the methodology and the calculation system. So we just simply following. I think some of you who are in the gas industry, they know that we also have a gas index in the country. This is a little more detailed one compared to that one. And we are bringing out this once in 2 months, unlike the gas, which is for 6 months once. So I think perhaps in future, we may like to get it in month-wise also. But initially, we plan to do it every 2 months once we would like to have National Coal Index. I think now I request Mr. Rajesh to speak on the steps taken by the Government of India for import substitution.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. So let me begin by saying that this commercial mining policy has a clause approved by the appropriate authority, the competent authority, is that the commercial miner can not only use coal in his own plant or sell in the domestic market or sell to his affiliate, but he's also free to export coal. So government is thinking not only in terms of containing import, but also exporting coal, enabling the commercial miner to export coal. Now, coming back to the specific question of steps taken to contain import of coal at present, I'll give you statistics of last year and this 18-19 and 19-20. In 18-19, country imported 242 million ton of coal, which included coking and non-coking both. I'll give the breakup later. And the foreign exchange which outgo was 1,72,000 crores of Indian rupees. In 19-20, the provisional figures suggest that country imported about 247 million ton of coal. And the foreign exchange outgo was nearly of the same order, which was in 18-19. In this import, which country has imported in this import basket, there are two components which we assume that are not readily substitutable. One is import of coking coal. This is in the order of this, the quantity is to the tune of about 50 million ton. And we assume, because our country does not have coking coal of the quality or features or properties which are required for the steel sector. So we perforce import that coal. And probably for some more time, it will continue to be imported. And the second component is non-coking coal, which is imported by power plants, which are designed to operate on imported non-coking coal, which again is to the tune of about 47 million ton. So roughly about 100 million ton of the import is reasonably assumed to be not immediately substitutable. Maybe in course of time, we have more coal available, more such type of coal available such, with such properties. So that leaves us with about 130 million ton of non-coking coal, which we assume and believe and work on to substitute. In this substitutable component, about 28 million ton was imported by power plants, which are designed to operate on domestic coal. This has been our first target. This has been government's first target, that we supply coal to these power plants which can operate on domestic non-coking coal so that they do not import coal. So this has been our first target. As you know, coal is presently sold only by PSUs, mainly Coal India Limited, its subsidiaries, or Singareni Coalry Company. So these are only two government sector companies which actually sell coal in the open market or through FSA or through auction. So first step has been that these companies have been interacting with each single importer power plant. whether it is in the southern part of India, where it is a challenge to take coal there, in like Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Karnataka, or to the westernmost part of India, northwestern part, not western, let's say northwestern part of India. There also some coal import happens. So these have been individually tied up. Ministry of Power and Central Electricity Authority, which are the nodal, which is the nodal ministry and the authority for power sector, they have also not only issued a letter, but they have impressed upon each single power plant or the state gencos or the central genco not to import coal, depend on domestic availability of coal, which is available in plenty. Just reiterate, about 50 million ton, in fact more, coal is already with the power plant, which is sufficient to generate 30 days of power. Coal India has about 77 million ton of coal at its pit head, which is unprecedented quantity of coal available with Coal India at this point in time. This may be because of the current pandemic situation that we are in. In any case, this quantity of coal which is available with Coal India at its pit head or with the power plants is at record high level. So this is one set of consumers who are importing, who imported. Some perforce because coal could not be transported to their power plants. But this year, they have agreed. They have entered into arrangement with coal supplier PSUs so that domestic coal is supplied to them and these plants do not end up importing coal in this year. Secondly, we are also making a coordinated effort, taking other ministries also into with our team. It's a coordinated approach is required. So we are also working through an interministerial committee. Those ministries, those sectors which have imported coal or those are the potential importers of coal, we have roped in those ministries in the group, like Steel, Ministry of Steel, DPIIT, or Ministry of Mines. These ministries deal with those sectors which are the largest importers of non-coking coal. So with them, we are approaching the individual companies, mostly in the non-regulated sector, non-power sector, those who have imported coal in the last year. So we have a fair idea that as this company or as this plant imported coal in 2019-20, and if we assure coal supply to this power or to this plant in this year, in 2021, so logically in this year they should not be importing. We are working on that approach. So we have roped in the ministries. Coal companies have interacted with these companies, everybody, they have also communicated. Tomorrow and day after tomorrow, 19th and 20th, they are interacting with cement sector and steel sector. Because of the present situation, it cannot be a physical one-on-one meeting. It has to be through a virtual mode. But it could be in a group of a sector or also the individual plants and players in that sector. So that Coal India is organizing it tomorrow, day after tomorrow. But they have been interacting with the sector industries in last about 3 weeks, more than 3 weeks they have been interacting. And they have also tied up some supplies to such companies, such power plants which imported coal in last year. So we hope that this year we have set an ambitious target that we will reduce about 100 million ton of imported coal this year. That's a very ambitious target. There is a challenge in that, but certainly coal companies are geared up to meet up to that challenge and they're working towards it. So there are the specific steps which I have told you. We are also engaged with the in the division which deals with coal supply. We are almost on a daily basis, forenoon, afternoon basis, we also interact with these companies so that they do not import. We need to know what is the constraint, why are they importing? Is it because quality of coal or properties of the coal, or is it because there is a transportation issue, or is it because of some economics? The landed cost of imported coal makes more economic sense to that plant than to consume domestic coal. So we need to understand it specific plant by plant, what is the issue with that plant, why is that plant importing. So that we worked on that, we are still working on that. So that is the approach that we have followed. And we hope that there will be a substantial reduction of import in this financial year 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rajesh. You know, in the morning we mentioned about the interest and the initiatives taken by the ministry to mine the coal in an environmental friendly manner. Recently, we have taken a number of measures on sustainable mining of coal. We have put in some standards, we have set up a cell. I think now I have my colleague, Mr. Bhavani Pathy, Joint Secretary, who deals with environmental issues in the ministry, to inform you the measures taken by the Ministry of Coal on ensuring that we are environmental friendly. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. For sustainable mining of coal, we have a cell in Ministry of Coal now, which is known as Sustainable Development Cell, which deal with all the environmental aspects of coal mining. Coal mining requires a lot of breaking of land. So land is the most important resource for a coal mine, and land degradation is the major concern of all coal mining activities. Then it is followed by different air pollution activities, then water pollution related things, then lastly about the mine closure. Nowadays lot of methods are available which can deal with the land degradation activities. It includes technical reclamation of the land, biological reclamation of the land, reuse of these overburdens, reuse of these land for different purposes like tourism, like big afforestation activities, commercial plantations, fisheries, and also the overburden can be used in terms of extracting sands, boulders, stones, which can be again reused by some other industries like road, infrastructure building, etc. Then another aspect is pollution control measure. For pollution control measure, everybody knows the MOFCC's norms about PM10, PM25, SOX and NOx. Lot of new technologies are available. We are promoting that, including big water sprinkler to automated water sprinkling activities, biological barrier for noise pollution. And the water pollution also, both on underground and surface water. We are prescribing different water treatment plant. We are also facilitating all the coal companies for reuse of those water for community purpose. These water can be treated and provided to the community nearby, maybe villagers, cities. And in many places also, these water are used for irrigation purpose also. Few of our coal mine also now using these water for industrial purpose. They are giving these water to the big power plants and different industries, and they are earning a handsome price from them. Mine closure also is one of the major activities. And everybody knows about mine closure fund. Per hectare is approximately 6 lakh rupees you have to deposit during the time of preparation of this mining plan. There should be a mining closure plan, and there is an escrow account maintained by the CEO. All these mine closure activities should be in a very systematic manner, progressive manner. And mine closure activities are done by maybe by the coal company in the initial phase, in the intermediate phase or the final phase, as per the type of mine. If it is underground mine, the mine closure activities is slightly different. If it is an open cast mine, mine closure activities different. So all these activities which are carried out by these coal companies, we are guiding them, we are mentoring them, We are counseling them. We are organizing different activities for them to be at least sensitized about all these things and to avoid any kind of environmental degradation or pollution in these local areas. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhavani. Now, CMPDI, Mr. Sekhar Saran is here. Would you like to make any other comments apart from the coal mines? Mr. Saran? Are you there with us?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do you like to make any other comments regarding the mines?
Sir, just I would like to supplement whatever I have informed this house. Next round, we'll be having more number of coking coal mines, sir.
See, I am asking you to sell the whatever coal mines I am offering now. I don't want you to tell them in future what I am going to offer. Okay, that will dampen the.
One point which I would request CMPDIL to convey to all the prospective bidders. In some of the mines, you have stated that these mines are in the high conservation zone HC high conservation value zones. So these are actually mineable,
correct?
Certainly mineable,
and yes, sir,
which will require a clearance of that specific whatever is the conservation area required. So these are very good mines. This is what I have learned. Though I am not from coal sector, not from coal mine area, but this is what I have learned, that these are very good mines, good grade of coal, and certainly mineable. So I think you should convey that to the. Because that was one point which was noted everywhere I see. Yeah, at least in the 41 mines, there are about 7 mines of this nature. 7
yes,
or 8.
So there are 2, 4, around 8 mines.
Eight.
We have mines
that
which have been identified as mines under high conservation zone.
High conservation zone shouldn't convey that there is very high conservation, so it has to be done. There, it is certainly mineable. Mine plan can be approved. Some clearances may be required from MOEF or from the local forest officials, and certainly very good mines with good grade of coal.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Now we do we have Samco linked? Shardul, Amarchand Mangaldas, if they want to make any comment.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you're not audible. The voice is not clear. Is a connection problem at your end? No, not audible. Not audible. So you're not audible, sir. Your voice is not reaching out. There's a disturbance in the connection, sir. Yeah.
There's.
No, not audible, sir. Internet, there's some disturbance. Yeah, visual is clear, but I don't know how.
I think you're not visible. You're visible, but not audible. So what we are going to do is, you try to reconnect. I think maybe another 5 minutes. Till that time, I'll like to engage the guests by answering a couple of questions. I think a couple of questions they ask. Broad questions, I'm reducing it to. One is, would the government encourage energy efficient technologies in mining sector? That's one. Obviously, yes. In fact, we would like to encourage the energy efficient technologies. And we have been asking our own coal companies to go for that. And we also largely this year asked the coal companies to go for the MDO route for mining the coal instead of the government or the coal company route, so that more efficiencies could be achieved. And the MDOs have been asked to hire more efficient technologies in extracting the coal. And we don't have any incentives for this specific purpose, but given the nature of the mines now on offer, large mines, these are all only possible if there are more efficient technologies and machineries are available in the country. And one idea we had when we offering these mines was to attract the foreign participation, was to make to have the large size mines. Now here we have very large mines, and the mining companies operating outside, they may find it attractive to invest in India and also mine. The steps we have taken, some people ask about what steps the government has taken to attract foreign mining companies from abroad. Now we have been in touch with the US private sector, coal mining private sector. We have also been in touch with Australian, and we are in touch with the foreign embassies located in India and our own embassies located abroad. We are given the large number of information and brochures, everything that is available, the terms and conditions of the auction. Now we today, for the today meeting event launching, I got this information that I think about 60 participants from abroad have logged into the system to watch the launching of the event. We also keep getting correspondence from the large number of foreign companies on the launching of the auctions. So we hope that foreign bidders, at least some foreign bidders will be there who will be willing to take a bet on investing in India on the coal mining sector, especially when Europe, it is almost now no new coal mines are being set up. The financial institutions have stopped financing these coal mines. US also, there is a headwinds against the coal, except in the coal belt southern states. Now the India offers enormous opportunity for those people who are still in the coal business to invest, and we hope to tap them. And any one of you are here attending today at the launch, would request you to keep the interest alive and have check on the coal blocks and tell us if there is something more we can do so that it will be attractive. Now Mr. I think now I hope Shardul Amarchand is able to connect, speak. I think can you speak us? But he is not audible. Okay, I think we'll any one of you might want to make any comments? That we have all answered. This we have received before the our presentations. So, okay, I think if we are not able to hear him, sorry for this. And I thank all the industrialist guests who are logged into the to watch the technical session. Thank you so much. We hope we try to answer all possible questions. And most of the I would also like to request every one of you to send us the questions, queries, or doubts or suggestions, if any, and we would like to answer them and then post it on our website so that everyone who is interested in the coal mines can take a look at it. And thank you so much. Thank you for joining, and I also thank Fiki for organizing this beautiful event on 18th. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. With mask, I talk about. Without mask. See, pop.